Good morning. Welcome to Journey Community Church Virtual Church. We're week three, and today is Palm Sunday. We're so glad that you have chosen to join us this morning. We pray that this time will be a meaningful time of worship for you and any who are in isolation with you in your home. What we want to do to start our gathering, we've been doing this every week. We hope it's been an enjoyable and meaningful time for you. We want you to pause the video in just a minute and go scour your house for something that you can use for communion elements, some type of bread-ish thing, some type of liquid that you can drink. Go get those, have those ready. And we also want you to go scavenge for something else. If you have made palm branches in preparation for Palm Sunday, we want you to go and get those. If you haven't, or you don't have palm branches in your house or yard, go ahead and go get some coats or some towels or blankets or something like the people used to lay on the donkey for Jesus to ride and to lay on the streets to make a path for him to come. So, pause the video, go get communion elements and palm branches or something that you can use as your symbol of the triumphal entry. Welcome back. We're going to worship together, starting out with a Hosanna song. And we encourage you during this time, if you're able, to wave your palm branches or to lay your coats down and make a path in your home. Maybe you walk on the path and wave your palm branches, but in some way, rejoice with us as we sing the Hosanna song.
All our praises, Hosanna. tears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
That was a fun thing for you to do with your family as we worship the Lord. And I want us to look at the scripture that tells the story of the triumphal entry that we are recognizing on Palm Sunday today. We're going to read it responsively. It comes from Matthew chapter 21. I'll read the parts that say one, and you can read the parts that say all. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them,
"Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away."
This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet.
"Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey."
The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted,
"Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven."
When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?"
The crowds answered, "This is Jesus."
And as I've been thinking and reflecting on this story this week, maybe you have been too. The crowds and the people, they were so excited that Jesus was coming in, and he's coming riding on a donkey, which was a symbol that a king would do that in times of peace. And they're accepting him. They're saying, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the Son of David." They're recognizing him as the Messiah, declaring him as the Messiah. But they're thinking of him in terms of a king, a conqueror, a military figure. And what they're missing in this whole Palm Sunday scenario, what they're missing is that Jesus came, yes, as those things, but as a suffering servant, not as a militant figure. And when I think of the suffering that Jesus is kind of staring down the barrel at right now at this point in his life, and I think about he is also King and Messiah, and the way that he's going to save is through suffering, my mind like can't even get around that. That it is so other, and it is so the holiness of God, the way of God that is just unable to be really fully comprehended by us as human beings. Yet that's the kind of life that God calls us into too, a life of victory and living in salvation, but also of suffering and suffering with others and entering into the suffering of others. So we're going to kind of make a turn in our service from the loud hosannas to worshiping the holy, holy God. And I want to encourage you, if you're able and if this would be meaningful to you, to actually change your posture or your position and kneel down on the floor beside your palm branches or beside your path that you made, to kneel before the holy God as we sing together.
Holy, holy, holy. Oh. Free.
filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name.
Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water. So
suffering and darkness in the world, and it's really hard sometimes to see your glory. We adore you because you came down into that, because you became flesh. You entered into every moment of suffering that we experience, to every moment of fear and anxiety, to every unknown situation, unknown future. You came into that. So Lord, we adore you today as both King and Messiah, and also as the one who walks along beside us in our suffering. You are holy. You are incomprehensible. We cannot get our minds around the majesty and the lowliness of who you are, merciful and mighty God. I want to encourage you, church, now to take a few moments and on your own or with your families to pray a prayer of adoration, to tell God how much and why you adore him. Today we say, along with the crowds, Hosanna, save us. But it feels like it has a totally different context and meaning to us today as we plead for your salvation. For your salvation of our souls, we trust you for that. We pray for the salvation of our communities, of our families, of our own physical bodies, of our world. Hosanna, save us. Lord, we thank you this morning that you are a God that despite what we experience and despite the suffering that we walk through, the struggles that we face, the fears and anxieties that we experience, you are a God who became flesh. You are incarnational love, and you are beside us walking through all of this. And not just walking through all of this with us, but in the middle of all of this, Lord, you still paint the sky with a sunset. You still paint the sky with the sunrise every morning. You still display your power in the thunder and the rain and the lightning. You are still evident in all of creation. Lord, all thy works declare thy praise in earth and sky and sea. And so we thank you, God, for that juxtaposition, that crazy like greatness, but also humility that is all wrapped up in you. And we know that that is your way, God, that you are calling us both to places of victory and peace and salvation, but also to places of incarnational love as we walk alongside of those who are suffering, as we suffer ourselves, and as we walk through very difficult times as the human race right now. So we thank you again, God, for who you are. We want to tell you that we trust you, we adore you, we praise you, we worship you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.
With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Hello, Journey community. Welcome today to Palm Sunday, one of the greatest and best days of the church calendar, where normally we would fill this place waving Hosanna branches, proclaiming Jesus is King. And unfortunately, we have to do this at a distance, but thank God that He is present with us all. And that even when something that is by nature, by its essence, communal, like gathering together to worship and sing and praise and hear from the word of the Lord, when we can't do that, that God is still present with us in the same way. And so I just want to thank you for your continued support and participation, and ask that God would be with us all to bless and keep us all and to align us in His way today. I also want to take a minute to just say thank you for your continued generosity. You guys are always so faithful to be a part of Journey. It is sort of in our DNA that we are generous people, that we are consistently generous people, and I want to thank you for that. And just to remind you also that we have a fund called the Generosity Project. That is our fund for the sake of others, that 100% of what is given to that fund is leveraged to help and benefit people who are struggling, whether it be from this pandemic or from other things in life. And so I'm going to encourage you to, as you are able, that when we are prone to grasp and hold tightly to and grasp for control, that we would maintain our posture of open hands to the presence of Christ in our lives, to what Jesus is calling us to, and to His embrace working in and through us. One of the things that my family has been doing over the past couple of weeks as we've been in our isolation is that we have been praying that God would somehow, some way work in and through us. And you would be amazed, I'm amazed, at some of the opportunities that God has placed right before us in order to be able to be His light and love in the life of people. And one of the ways that I want to share with you today is on Fridays, my family has had a long-standing tradition that we eat donuts on Friday morning. We even have a song. We sing, donuts for me, donuts for you, donuts for your mama and your auntie too. See, nobody else is here, so I can sing and not be muted. But we sing this song, and Fridays has an excitement because of donuts, and we go to a donut shop that's just a ways from our house, and we go to the same donut shop over and over and over again, and the family that runs it is a beautiful family. They're always happy. They're always cheerful. They're always so excited and appreciative of our business. Last week, I was in, and I began to sense that there was a lot of tension and uncertainty in the shop. And so I was asking her about it, and she was saying that she didn't know whether they were going to be able to stay open. This is hitting her very hard. And so I paid for my donuts, and I reached into my wallet, and I handed her a donation. And she was taken aback by it. She at first didn't accept it. She went like this and said, no. And I said, yes, please take it. And she was so happy and appreciative and exciting. Well, this week I went in and paid for my donuts, and she said, I just want to thank you so much. She said, we were so moved by that. My daughter was so moved by that. She made us take a picture with your donation and posted it on Facebook, and we were just so appreciative of it. And I say that not to get any sort of credit, but to suggest that it is part of our responsibility as followers of the way of Jesus, yes, to maintain our connection to the church, yes, to maintain our connection to our friends and family and neighbors, but also to help people in times of need, whatever their need might be, to as much as we are able to help and bless them. So I want to encourage you to find ways to bless people. And I'm going to give you a little update here on the fuzz above my lip. I am losing my resolve to continue to fool myself that I could actually achieve anything other than peach fuzz. But the worst part about this is that Kelly is really hesitant to kiss me. And you know, as they say, if you can't kiss during quarantine, what else can you do? So maybe this fuzz is short-lived. You'll have to tune in next week to see how that happens. Over the past several weeks, we've had some different conversations about the earliest followers of Jesus and the early church, and how they were and how the Spirit was working in them. Last week in particular, we talked about the earliest followers of Jesus from the time of his arrest and death and resurrection to the day of Pentecost, when things were clouded over, when they were in fear, when they were in hiding, and the Spirit enlightened them, illuminated them, and moved them out beyond their fear and anxiety and stress and locked doors into the world for the sake of others, to embody the love of Jesus. And the early church, one of the things that marked their worship, one of the things that marked their association as the church, was that they were extravagantly generous. They believed that they were actually embodying the love of Jesus through their good works and love for others and love for God. That they were actually being Jesus's hands and Jesus's feet. That when they acted, it was the body of Christ acting in the world. And they had this inner bravery to face very uncertain and difficult times. In fact, they even were able to not fear death. You see, the power of the way of fear is death. The power of the way of selfishness and greed is death. But God is the author, the power of life. That God's presence is life. That God fills us, fills our lives and our lungs with his life. And that even death is powerless in the light of Christ and in the light of life. And this love within them, this power of the Spirit within them, this movement going on within them, moved them to do incredibly dangerous and difficult things. For instance, when plagues would come to a certain part of the world, everyone else would flee. They didn't have the ability to social distance in their home because they had to be out in order to get food and all of those things that were a part of their culture. So they had to just leave and find homes elsewhere. But when the masses exited an area, that there were all sorts of people who were left, the ill, the vulnerable, they were left. And many Christians stayed behind in order to care for them, to help them, and to comfort them in their pain. The earliest Christians, when there is fear of others, when there is xenophobia, which is something that people always struggle with, but especially in times of pandemic, and especially of times that are fearful and uncertain, we have this fear of others that pervades us and in many ways paralyzes us. But the earliest followers of Jesus rejected this xenophobia, this fear of others, and embraced a xenophilia, a love for others. And God worked in and through them in miraculous ways to share his love and to shine his light. And the early church blossomed and matured and grew into something spectacular and miraculous. We live in a culture today where the only time that matters is right now. How many of us over the past couple of weeks have found ourselves frustrated by the fact that we can't order something on Amazon that's deemed non-essential and it arrive at our doorstep the next day, right? And we know that there's good reason for this. We know that there are people around the world that need essential goods and that Amazon is getting them to them. But the expense of that is that I can't get what is non-essential when I want it. And even though we understand the reason behind it, we're still frustrated by it. Our land is one in which convenience is king and abundance is our security. In general, we have lost the art of patience and waiting, which is problematic for us now because we have been abruptly thrown into a new normal where we have no choice but to wait. We wait in fear for the time when us or one of our loved ones will be diagnosed with the virus. We wait for our jobs to be available again or for our offices to open again. We wait for the store to be stocked fully with toilet paper and rice. We wait for financial help for the government. We wait for this threat to subside. The values of convenience and abundance are being threatened, and today we have no idea for how long and how deeply they will be affected. Yet in this uncertain time, us followers of the way of Jesus have a unique opportunity to unlearn some faith inhibitors that we have more than likely unknowingly adopted over our journey. You see, convenience and abundance are great values when it comes to toilet paper and food and the economy, but are actually enemies of our faith development. I've read several different passages in Psalms this week, and it seems like that every time, to some degree, the Psalms that I have read have said something about, God, my enemies are pressing in on me. Free me from my enemies. Deliver me from my enemies. I am running from my enemies, but they are catching up to me. Now, fortunately, in our society, we don't really have many enemies in the traditional sense of someone who wants to inflict harm on us. But we definitely are pursued and chased by the enemies of selfishness and greed and fear and anxiety. And it is the desire of these coercive powers that we would succumb to their allure. But in Psalm 31, it says this, I trust in you, Lord. You are my God. My times are in your hands. So deliver me from the hands of my enemies, from those who pursue me. Let your face shine on your servant. Save me in your unfailing love. The unfailing love of God covers us and frees us from the power of our enemies. My arch enemy right now is crabgrass. Kelly and I were fortunate last summer to purchase a home where the previous homeowners took great care of the lawn, and now all we have to do is sort of maintain it. But even still, I am fighting a war against the enemy of crabgrass. Now, I'm not a lawn aficionado. I know that if you mow grass, it looks nice. If you let it grow, it looks bad, and that's about it. So I'm pretty much helpless when it comes to a battle with crabgrass. But I've done a lot of research to try and figure out what is going on and what can I do about this problem, this invasion of crabgrass in my lawn. And what I have unfortunately found out is that at this point in time, after the crabgrass is mature, there's really not much you can do. You can buy chemicals that will kill things that are cool season weeds, like dollarweed and clover and those kinds of things. But when it comes to crabgrass, there really is very little defense. And as I have been disheartened by this information, and now that I'm spending much more time at home, that crabgrass is just taunting me. Jonathan, I'm growing uncontrollably. I'm spreading my stalks and leaving my seeds deposited so that even when you pull me up, I'm still gonna grow. Jonathan, come get me. And it is calling at me constantly and frustrating me to no end. But the only thing that I am able to do today is to go out and to try and pull up as much of it as possible. But the frustrating part is that even when I uproot some crabgrass, that it sprinkles its seeds, and the next day in the place where I uprooted one bunch, there's another bunch that is sprouting. And this brings us to an important illustration when it comes to our lives. Is that oftentimes we think that it is enough for us to just say no and to uproot the enemy. But the reality is that if we fail to embrace practices to fill the voids that are left behind by the uprooting, there are seedlings of the enemy within us that will germinate and will continue to grow without us dealing with them. When it comes to crabgrass, they will tell you that, first of all, you have to have some sort of pre-emergent in the fall, which is already past time, before it starts to germinate. But then they'll tell you that the best way to rid yourself of crabgrass is to have a healthy lawn that covers the soil so that the sunlight can't penetrate the grass in order to help germinate the seeds that are left behind. And in the same way, the Spirit works in our lives through prayerful and life-giving practices to uproot the seeds, to uproot the roots of our enemies in our lives, of frustration and fear and greed and selfishness, and then provides a blanket to cover us, restricting the growth of the seedlings that remain that haven't been dealt with. But the thing about crabgrass and the thing about faith development in our lives is that these things take time. They don't happen overnight. There is no easy catch-all solution. There's no cutting corners. There's no just believing that the crabgrass is going to all of a sudden be gone. No, it takes time and it takes patience and it takes waiting. As Eugene Peterson said, it is a long obedience in the same direction. God is not in a hurry. God is infinitely patient. There is never a time in Scripture where God is in a hurry or where God is rushed. There are times when people are in a hurry and people are rushed, but that is their fear leading them. That is their anxiety leading them. That is their selfishness and their greed leading them, not the Spirit of God. God is never in a hurry, and God's love for us goes deeper than we will ever know. But if we allow the voices of fear to rush this process of uprooting and covering in our lives, we will miss out on God's deep and patient work. We will be driven by our fear to rely on our own efforts and control instead of trusting in God's love and grace. This is Palm Sunday, and as we said earlier, I wish so deeply that we could fill this place and wave our Hosanna branches as hard and as fast as we possibly can, but obviously we can't do that, and my heart hurts for that. And next year, we're blowing the top off of this thing during Holy Week. But Palm Sunday celebrates the triumphal entry of Jesus into the streets of Jerusalem, where upon Jesus' arrival, people are waving palm branches, shouting, Hosanna, 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 proclaiming the King is here. And the Scriptures tell us that there's all of these people who are wondering what's going on, and they're asking about it, and they're telling them, the King is here, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. And the Scriptures say that many believed. But we know where this story is going. And soon after Jesus is welcomed as King, the same believers traded in their Hosannas for shouting, we have no king but Caesar. What changed? Well, their belief reached its limit. Their belief ran out. Up until this point, their belief was sufficient. Their belief led them to do extraordinary things for some of them, causing them to leave their life and their families behind. But in even doing so, even in such a miraculous movement of God in their lives, they found themselves rendered afraid and in denial because of their circumstances when their belief ran out. You see, belief is the easy part, but belief giving shape and form to the way of Jesus in our lives is something much more, something so much more that the only way for that to happen is for us to surrender to the Holy Spirit's work in our lives. For those of us who are Cowboys fans, in the early 90s, Jimmy Johnson spoke regularly a phrase back when the Cowboys were good and they were actually worth rooting for, that it's not enough to talk the talk, that you also have to walk the walk. Belief is the equivalent of the talk. You see, belief in eating healthy to be healthy is actually powerless to make me healthy. The only way for me to be healthy is for me to eat healthy. Belief that late night binge shopping on Amazon is bad for my budget is powerless in helping me save money and not spend my budget. The only way for me to accomplish that is to actually stop spending money and to save. You see, this is where the rubber hits the road, that belief is only worth the degree that it forms and shapes our actions. And the tree of faith formation, belief is the lowest hanging fruit, which poses a unique problem for us in our day and age because we tend to value belief above all else. But eventually, our belief will reach its limits. Belief doesn't weather storms well. This is why hosannas are traded so quickly for "we have no king but Caesar." This is why Peter, in one breath, says, "Jesus, I will die for you," and in the next breath, he denies that he ever even knew him. This is why we believe in intimacy and connection, but struggle so hard to put our phones down. Belief has very little formative value. Now you might say, well, belief that you actually believe has formative value. But the reality is that for these earliest followers of Jesus, they believed in him enough to leave behind house and home, yet they still found themselves in a place where their eventually their belief ran out. And as a result of Jesus' arrest and death, it moved these earliest followers of him into a way of destruction and fearful patterns instead of in the life-giving way of Jesus. One of the final teaching moments that Jesus shared with his disciples was a parable that he told about a king that was doing the work of separating sheep and goats. Now, when you first read this parable, you might ask, why is the king doing work of a servant? You see, in Jesus's kingdom, the king is the servant. And as Jesus tells this parable, the defining feature that separates the sheep from the goats isn't what the sheep logically and cognitively believes and what the goat doesn't believe, but how the sheep are formed into the servant identity of the king while the goats are settling for a traditional hierarchy. And through this parable, Jesus is leading us to see clearly what is usually clouded over in our lives. That there is Jesus's way and that there are other competing ways of greed and selfishness and fear and anxiety. And that both of these ways are at work in our lives, and we have to rely on Jesus's way working patiently and slowly within us to produce the fruit of the kingdom in our lives. The trouble is, though, that for many of us, we do everything that we possibly can to limit things that are slow and cause us to wait in patience in our lives. Often at the expense of a formative and constantly deepening awareness of God. Now, in Christian culture today, many of us possess a resolve that whatever comes my way, my belief is never in question. And we have resolved enough that no matter what we face, that our belief in God will never change. And we have traded in our questions for certainty, which on surface level seems like a good trade. But the reality of certainty is that for many of us, we find ourselves plateaued in our certainty, which means that there are no steep falls or no downward turns, but a plateau, just as much as it doesn't go down, also doesn't ascend, it doesn't go up. And so our new awareness of God's goodness and beauty is severely limited when our faith is plateaued. You know, what tends to happen for us as followers of Jesus is that in the beginning, when following the way of Jesus is new to us, it's explosive. It calls into question all of our behavior, all of our actions, all of our beliefs, our whole selves, and many of us undergo drastic change as new believers in the way of Jesus. But at some point in time, that newness wears off, and we find ourselves on this plateau, and there needs to be something to break us out of that. You know, a yard that is full of weeds requires a lot of work. It requires daily, painstaking, methodical work. But the deal is that as long as our yard has more grass than weeds, then we can keep our yards manicured, and we can provide the illusion for people that as long as we keep them at a distance, that they won't see all of the weeds that are present. And what's even worse than that is that we can convince ourselves that the weeds aren't so bad after all. And we can even move from that to a where we grow fond for the weeds, like a child who sees dandelions pop up out of the ground and says, "Oh wow, wildflowers, how pretty." We can look at the weeds in our lives and respond in the same way. You know, I have said many times, and now I try to catch myself from saying it, but I have said many times, I am who I am. For better or for worse, like it or not, I am who I am. And maybe you have said that too. And the reality is that, yes, we are who we are. I am who I am. You are who you are. As far as our personalities go, our interests, the things that we like, the way in which we respond to suffering and pain and tragedy, the way in which we respond to beauty and love and joy, we are who we are. And who we are is created, and who we are is ultimately good because God says that it is. But I am who I am does not and should not apply to the destructive patterns in our lives, to the patterns of our lives that build up walls and lead us into isolation, to where we keep others out either because we are afraid of them or because we don't want them to get too close to see all of the weeds that exist. And when we operate under this mentality of we are who we are, then there is little ability for the Spirit to bring change in our lives, because the reality is that we are helpless to make these significant and deep changes. We are relied on the power of God in us, of the love of God in us, and thanks be to God that He is present, working in our lives patiently, slowly, painstakingly, methodically, weeding out the things that the ways of fear and anxiety and stress and greed and selfishness in our lives, and replacing them with beauty and love and peace. But we have to make ourselves available in order for the Spirit to be able to work in that way. It has been said many times that religion is the opiate of the masses. And it may surprise you to know that I fully agree with that statement. That religion, insofar as it is based in fear of death, fear of the other, fear of judgment, fear of getting it wrong, fear of being infiltrated by the enemy, fear of making the wrong choices and the wrong decisions and believing the wrong things. Anything that is based in fear, any religion that is based in fear, is the opiate of the masses. But a faith that is based in the love of Christ and the work of the Spirit in our lives, and the beauty of always awakening to the new wonder and praise of God's goodness, that is the exact opposite of the opiate of the masses. That is a stimulant for us, a stimulant for love and beauty and joy and peace in our lives. And my prayer for us during this time of isolation, as we know that God is working in this time, not that God causes it, but is working in and through this time to display his love and joy and peace in and through our lives. My hope for us is that we will adopt habits and practices, both individually and collectively in our families, that lead us more into the image of Christ for the sake of others. And that once we emerge out of this, once we go back to some sort of semblance of normal, that these practices will become abnormally familiar in our daily lives, to where we allow the way of Jesus to form and shape us much more than our situations and our surroundings. Journey, let me pray for us. Jesus, today we come before you and we lay ourselves at your feet. Jesus, we are in awe that you are the servant king. But Jesus, submitting ourselves to a life of embracing the sacrificial love of the cross is hard, and you know that, and you agonized over that yourself, and you prayed that the Spirit would come and dwell in us to shape and form us into your image for the sake of others. And we thank you that we are not out here trying to do this alone, that we are not limited by what we can control, because we can't control much of anything, as this situation has pointed out to us. But your Spirit is working and forming and shaping and moving us away from fear. Jesus, your word teaches us that you have not given us a spirit of fear. So anything that we are afraid of, whether that be afraid of punishment, afraid of judgment, afraid of ridicule, afraid of making the wrong choices, afraid of any of that, that you would bind that from us, that enemy of fear would be bound from our lives, that we would run from it, and that we would be set free to your life and to your love and to your peace and to your Spirit that is at work within us, moving, shaping, molding us into who you want us to be. Jesus, may it be so for all of us, and may we seek by the power of your Spirit to be people who never take anything for granted, who are never unresponsive, and who are constantly awakening to the new wonder and praise of your goodness. Jesus, may it be so today in our lives. Amen and amen. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. I want to pause just for a moment and let's take a minute to give God thanks and praise, not for our situation, but that God is working in and through our situation, that God is working in and through us to embody his love and peace. Let us profess together who God has called us to be. We are a community of people following the way of Jesus and learning to be present. Let us remember the words the Lord Jesus said on the night which he was betrayed. He took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Jesus' death is not defeat. It is not fear. It should not cause us to be afraid. Jesus' death is the servant king laying down his life for the sake of his people and for the sake of the world. And when we participate in, when we celebrate in the Lord's death, when we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes, we are proclaiming we will not be afraid, because greater is the Spirit of Christ that is in me than the Spirit that is in the world. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Today, let's come to the table of Jesus, that we might internalize this kingdom, that it may be our fuel, that it may be our nutrients, that it may nurture and move us into the image of Christ for the sake of others, away from fear, away from the stress and selfishness and greed and all of those ways, and alive in the way of Christ. Come today and eat and drink. Oh God, help us now to love as Christ loved. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. Give us the strength to serve you faithfully until the promised day of resurrection, when we will feast with you at your table of glory. In Christ's name and for his sake, amen. Now receive this benediction. May the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord turn towards you and give you peace. All of this today in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, which casts out fear and imparts perfect and merciful and servant love to us all. Amen and amen and amen. Stay safe. We love you guys. Amen.